Sunday. I hope you enjoyed this spectacular time of worship through music. Now, before we get to the message, here are a few things that we've got going on. Sunday, our kids are going to be putting on a Christmas play, telling the story of Christmas and what it's really all about. So you're going to want to be here because it's going to be fantastic, told through the eyes and the mouths of our children here. So it's going to be awesome. You're going to love it. So invite some friends and be here next Sunday.
Done it. Well, if you've already done it, that's good. This is just to encourage people at the end. So go ahead and see Kyle or anybody else on staff so we can get those 75 people registered. So, well, I'm not sure if I really want to get ice buckets of water on me, but you know what? Anything, if we can read the word, just to have some fun things with that. So we're going to have a great time today. One quick thing, I need to mention two quick things, actually. First of all, if you'd like to be, we have in December, we have our nominations for our board. This year, we have we'll be voting on three people. If you'd like to run for the board and be part of that, you have to be a member of the church. And talking about that, in the next few weeks, I'll have some announcements. We'll do a membership class in January. And you have some new people in the church. We'd love to learn more about our church and about how being part of our church. Membership of our church is a little bit different than any other church because we're an independent church. And so your vote here is very important, and it's part of the ownership of the church. Now, it doesn't mean if we sell the building, you get all the money. No, it just means you're part of ownership of a faith and how we bring people to the Lord Jesus Christ. And our Christmas party is going to be December 16th after church. We have the Christmas blessing that day, but it's also going to be our Christmas party as we thank all of you for all you've done this year. Our board will be serving the dinner. We have it catered in. My wife's taking care of all the desserts, so you do not have to bring anything. All you got to do is bring yourself. And we're going to have some wonderful games that are going on. We have a couple great prizes. We have $25, $50, and $100 gift cards to help you out with your Christmas season this year and different things like that. So we're going to have a wonderful time that day right after church on the 16th. And also remember, we have the Christmas Blessing families coming today. We have 109 people coming that day. It's not going to be great, and we want to be able to love on them and let them know that they are loved. And also, I want to let you know for your kids, after the Christmas play next week, even if your kids aren't in the play, they'll be in here to start the service. And then after the play is over, they'll have their regular children's church, and they're having their Christmas party next weekend. And so they're going to have a great time next weekend. Well, today we're continuing we're finishing our series on Sunday the 13th. Next week we're going to start a Christmas series. I'm going to talk about how Christmas is viewed through some certain people's eyes, like King Herod, John the Baptist, Simeon and Anna, after Jesus was born. We're going to see how God sees through the lens of how Jesus is viewed in so many different ways. It's going to be very exciting. But today we're going to finish our series and start the Christmas season off with 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We've been doing the different 13s in the Bible, and we're ending with this one today, because it talks about what Jesus came to do. It says this in 1 Corinthians 13:13, "And now abide faith, hope, and love. These three. But the greatest of these is chocolate." Isn't that what you get at Valentine's Day, right? You know, yeah. No, the greatest of these is love, you know. And we're going to be in 1 Corinthians 13 is known as the love chapter. It's appropriate that we talk about love during the Christmas season because, you know, it's a season we talk about what Jesus came to do. Love came down to earth. And it's considered
mistletoeing, and hearts will be glowing when loved ones are near. It's the most.
This is what we look forward to, right? Yes, this is why it's the most wonderful time of the year, right? Yeah, this is what we look forward to, right? No? You know, you don't want 7 feet of snow? This is the scene from Buffalo, New York a few years ago. I don't know why anybody wants to live in Buffalo. I don't understand that. They get it every single year, and they complain about it every single year. Move. Okay? This is so simple about that, okay? Lake effect snow. But you know what? This is, you know, we think of this, but you know, it's the most wonderful time of the year. Why? Because people seem to be a little bit nicer to each other, don't they? They seem to show a little bit of love. And that's why Jesus came down to show us what real love is, an example for us to follow. And not just this time of the year, but should be all year round. You know, people love this time of year because it seems that people are willing to help and do things. Wouldn't it be like that if people were like that all the time? You know, and that's what Jesus came to do. He came to show us at Christmas time how we should be all the time. And so we're going to start with the first three verses of this chapter. It says, "Though I speak with the tongues of men and angels, but I have not love, I have become a sounding brass or a clanging cymbal." And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I can remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor and to give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me what? Nothing. You know what people can do? These three verses talk about, you can have all, the first verse talking about tongues and it's talking about all the manifestation gifts, healings and all the things going on. You can have all the wonderful, powerful gifts in your life, but here's the deal. If you give a word in tongue or you do something in Jesus' name, but you don't do it in love, no one's going to care, will they? And it says, you know, you can understand everything you want to. You can be the most knowledgeable person in the world about the Bible and try to tell someone about Jesus, but if you don't have love, no one's going to listen to you. And then the last one talks about, you know, we can do all the good deeds we want to do. We can have the greatest works we can do, but if we don't do it in the spirit of love, they will not mean anything to the person. It won't bring about change. Because they'll just think, oh, well, they're just putting their good deed. They know when it's done in love and it's not done in love. And if you don't do it in love, it doesn't do anything. This quote here is from a guy named Dr. Hayden Robinson. He has this quote. Love is the thing, if a church has it, does not really need much else. And if it doesn't have it, whatever else it has doesn't really matter very much. You know, that's one of the reasons we're starting the care ministry. Next Sunday after church, we have a meeting for that. We need to really love one another intentionally. And this year, we're going to be doing things a little bit different because, you know what, that's what we have to promote first and foremost, is that we really care about each other, we really love each other, and we really want to, the three C's, to care, connect, and celebrate. We want to really emphasize that this year because, you know what, if we don't got that, we really don't got anything else, do we? You know, when you really love someone, the other things start to happen. And then God moves, and things happen with that. And and like last week, just as humility cannot just be words, neither can love be just in word. Love has to be a way we live. Jesus came at Christmas not to die for us and come back to life for us as we celebrate communion. That's not the only thing he came to do. But he came because he could have accomplished salvation in so many different ways. The reason he came to earth was to show us what love really is. And how we're supposed to live like him. He came to show us the right way. And this is key. This is singular. The right way to love. Because what's the problem? What do people mess up more than anything else in this world? Love, right? How many people fight over it? Well, I thought he loved me. He didn't love me. Or this, you know, all these different things. Even family relationships and friend relationships. All these things happen. Everybody has their own particular idea of how they should do love. Guess what? God says there is the right way to show love. And if we get it right, your life will be better. You will have a better life, and you'll have great things happen to you, but you got to do everything he asks you to do. And he also says he'll take care of something else, and we'll get to that in a moment. But let's read what love is about. It says 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 7. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy, does not parade itself, is not puffed up, does not behave rudely, does not seek its own, is not provoked, thinks no evil, does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Now, there's a lot of aspects to love. You say, that's a lot. Yeah, there is a lot. And it's kind of like a buffet. Anybody ever been to a buffet? Anybody ready to go to lunch right now? Okay, close the doors. All right, no, just kidding. But, you know, you go to a buffet and you see all the food out there and there's all kinds of choices right at a buffet. And you go up and you pick what you want to eat. And if you look at something you don't like, you kind of what? You pass on it. You know, when you know you have kids and they go to the buffet, right? We used to go to Golden Corral. I lived in Florida and my kids were younger. And they walk in, they see the whole place. They just wanted to go eat pizza and ice cream. All this wonderful food out there. You can get pizza anytime. You're at Golden Corral. You can have all the steak you want. You can have all this other stuff. And they, what do they want? Pizza. And it's really bad pizza because they're not caring about it. And then they just want to go right to the ice cream and the dessert bar and stuff their face full of that stuff, right? But there's this wonderful stuff on there because, you know, sometimes they look at it, oh, I don't want, ooh, green beans. I don't want that. peas, I don't want those. My kids still don't like peas. But, you know, it's great, wonderful things on there. And say, you know what? It's all good for you. And what God is trying to say is love, though, is not a buffet. All of these things, you need to have all of these things in your life in order to know genuine love. And he wants to have them all in you. And we can't just pick and choose which ones we want or don't want in our life. In order to love, we need to have all of these. And when you do it right, you'll actually know when you're being loved. You won't have to worry about how to decide because you'll be able to recognize it for real. And that's what God wants you to do. He wants you to know what pure love really is so you can experience it. He wants you to experience love in a way that is amazing. So let's talk about some different things about love. Love is not, we're going to go through these pretty quick. Love is not, the first thing it said, envious and jealous. What do you understand about love is love does not need to find itself in something else. God wants you to know that you are special. You are loved. He created you not because he said, well, I'm bored today. I'm just going to make a clump here today and make you. He made you in love. He loves you before you were born. And when he thought about you, he loved you. And you don't need to find it anywhere else and know that God loves you very much. The next thing love says is not, love is not boastful. And we find that in these words. It does not parade itself around. It is not puffed up. It does not seek its own. Love does not say, look at me. Me, 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 me. Love is not focused on me. Love is what? Love is focused on, I want to do something for someone else. I want to show love. I want to be able to give that out to other people. Love is confident. Now, there's a difference between confident and boastful. Okay? Boastful, you know, everybody, draw the attention to you. If someone needs to draw the attention to them, there's something wrong because you know what? There's something wrong inside of them, and they're not confident. God wants you to be confident. He wants to know that you have a purpose, and God wants to give power into your life, and God wants to take care of you, and God says you don't have to worry about it. He wants you to be like that. He wants you to walk around confidently. You don't need to go around and parade that around, because here's what happens. When you walk in confidence with the Lord will do things around you because he loves you. The next thing, what does God not want us to be? He does not want love to be rude. Now, you might think that's an easy, simple thing. But as I was praying about this, I was thinking about, you know, Lord, that's a simple thing. He wanted me to talk a little bit about that because we as Christians, and we love people, we need to love them in a certain way. We need to make sure that we're always doing the right thing. You know, sometimes people will say things and go, oh, they just pick on you because that shows they love you. You know, in the Bible, Jesus never picked on anybody. He always was loving and truthful and honest. He never put anybody down. Last night, we went to the Gaither concert, and it was a wonderful concert. If they come back next year, I encourage you all to go. It was amazing. Had a great time. And during the concert, Mark Lowry got up, and he did some of his jokes, and he's a funny guy, and I enjoy listening to him. And he said something that I belly laughed big time. And then last night, I was going to bed. God brought that one back to me, and he said, that's a good example for this today. I'm like, oh, and I thought about it. And he was telling the story about, you know, what if things happen today like it happened in Acts? First of all, I believe things can happen today like it happened in Acts. I believe the things that happened in Jesus' life can happen today. And there's a story about Jesus in the Gospels where this man was sick, and he couldn't get into the church or the building where Jesus was. So they had to cut a hole in the roof to get him in. So we're in last night. Hey Debbie, how you doing? You would have liked to have a hole in the roof last night, right? You waited out in the rain for what, 45 minutes? It was miserable. I mean, they didn't prepare. I mean, it was crazy last night. People waiting in the rain to get in to hear about Jesus Christ, but they couldn't get him in. So they lowered him down. They cut the roof and they lowered him down for Jesus to heal him. And Mark Lowry said, you know, imagine that happened today. And they lowered him down. And he said, if you go to a Baptist church, they lowered him down to Baptist church. What's a Baptist pastor going to do? Because they don't believe in the healing for today. That was his joke. And I laughed. And I was like, that was funny. But you know what? The people in the room, I love my Baptist brethren. And I kind of actually was pretty rude, if you think about it. He says, oh, what are they going to do? They're Baptist. I'm like, that was rude. You know, I know some Baptists, they believe in the full gospel. You know, we got to be careful how we talk to one another as Christians. You know, you might say something to somebody you might think you're joking about, and they might take it in a joking way. But you don't really know what they feel like down inside, do you? And also, you don't know how somebody around you might perceive that. You're a Christian. You said stuff like that. The world does it all the time because the world wants to put people down. That's what the world wants to do, because they want to make themselves feel better by putting someone down. Jesus says you feel better by lifting someone up and lifting everybody's spirit. And we need to be careful as Christians how we do that and when we do that. And it's a very important thing to do. The next, not to do. And it says, love is not what? Whoops, wrong one. I've been backwards. Love is not provoked. You know, in every relationship, whether it's a husband, wife, boyfriend, girlfriend, family, friend, coworker, we get provoked, don't we? Someone just is in our life that just takes the cattle prod and sticks us, don't they, right? And what God says, you know what? In order to truly love, we have to not be easily provoked. What's that mean is we need to be able to rise above it and say, you know, I'm going to be humble, but I'm still going to look on them in love, and I'm not going to return what they're doing towards me. I'm not going to let it affect my life, because you know what? My life is put up in Jesus. And we'll get to that in a second about how God does that, because it leads us to the next point is, love is not being evil. It said in our verses today, do not think evil and do not rejoice in iniquity. You know, love, we're not supposed to think evil towards anyone. You know, we're supposed to have compassion on one another. We're not supposed to say this, well, they're getting what they deserved. God says we should never think like that, because here's the problem. When you think like that, there will be a time when you're going to be the person who someone says they need to get what they deserve. You know, we're supposed to have compassion. Jesus, you know, he came down to earth. We didn't deserve his love. We've done a lot of things wrong in our life, but yet he still, what? Loves us. And we need to have that, because, you know, we need to look at people and say, you know what, even though they're doing something to me, I'm not going to return evil on them, even though that's our first inclination is to do that. Because we do that, we start down a slippery slope. But what if someone is abusing us? Does that happen in love? Sure does. You know, Jesus got abused all the time. Still does, doesn't he? His name's a swear word now, right? Isn't that terrible? But abuse can happen in so many ways. And Jesus says in the Bible, he doesn't say you have to stand there and take it. You don't have to stand there and be abused. You can move on. You can do that. What he is saying, though, when you get out of that thing, relationship, and he has many verses in the Bible, you don't have to be a wimp. God never said for us to stand there and be hit. He never said, like I said a few weeks ago, we're not supposed to be, devil has a target on it. Doesn't mean we have to stand put and let the bullet hit us. Okay, we're allowed to get out of the way from those things. We're allowed to do those things. And but here's what he's saying. He says, but when you do that, don't cross over into evil. Because only real love can ever change a person. Evil for evil only leads to more evil. And we tend towards that. And we need to stop. If we really want to experience love, we got to stop that. And it's not easy to do, but we need to do that, because when you start to return evil for evil, you know what you cut off? Being in love. See, love and evil cannot exist at the same time. You can't be in love and be, you can't get to, if you're being evil towards somebody, you will not be able to have a loving relationship with someone else. It will affect all of your relationships, because those two cancel each other out. Now, what does love do? Well, it says love rejoices in truth. You know, we want to be truthful, right? But part of loving is, you know, sometimes people aren't truthful, are they? Sometimes people mess up and don't tell the truth all the time. I don't know if you, how many times have you ever told your children, hey, did you do this? It better you tell me now than I find out when. Later, right? You know, I wish people would learn that. I see it all the time in adults, and they try to lie their way out of things, and then they find out they did it, and the punishment becomes even worse from the judge because they didn't own up to it in the first place. Jesus says we need to rejoice in truth. And that means if someone does something wrong to you and they come back to you and admit that, we need to rejoice our brother or sister that they want to get clean. They want to make it right. We shouldn't put them down and say, man, I knew you did that. Say, okay, you did that. I forgive you. Let's help you not do it again. Let's help you become better in the Lord. Because you know what? We're going to be on the other end of that sometimes too, aren't we? And we need to go say, I'm sorry and I was wrong. And in order for someone to get better, they have to be willing to come to somebody to do that. And so we have to do it in love. We have to rejoice in truth all the time. The next thing love does all the time is it bears, endures, and suffers all things. You know, when you really love somebody, you're going to put up with some things, aren't you? You know, and it's mentioned, these three things are mentioned three times in this passage because, you know, we've done a lot of things that Jesus puts up with us. The entire Old Testament is about this. The Israelites, he loves them, but yet they do things wrong. And then Jesus has to, what? He puts up with them. Delivers them time and time again. Then Jesus comes and shows us a new way. And then the rest of the New Testament is all the epistles are sent because people have done something wrong again. And Jesus needs to share with them through his writers, hey, I love you, but you know what? I'm putting up your name, but I need you to understand this is not the way it's supposed to be. You know, Peter has a story where he goes to Jesus and asks, how many times should I forgive my brother? And he said, he comes with a number seven times. Now, what I think is probably what's happening is he's spending time with the 12 disciples. As I told you last week, you know, the disciples were just like us, and they probably got on their nerves sometimes. And there's probably one disciple that got on Peter's nerve, and he was up to five or six times where he'd done something. So Peter goes to Jesus. He's thinking, when can I get rid of this guy? I want to get him out of my life. He says, I'm up to five or six, so maybe seven's a good number. He says, how many times do I got to forgive this person? Because the only reason he's asking is because it's actually happening in his life. And what's Jesus go? 70 times seven. And what's Jesus saying? Forgive him all the time. Don't keep count. You know, we need to bear and suffer and endure things because you know what? Jesus does that with us. And sometimes, and people are going to mess up and they need chances. We need to be willing to do that. And Jesus did this with us and he has held out for time. Look at the planet today and look where everything is going. He puts up with a lot from humanity. But yet we're still here today. And they need to know what love is. And he wants to do this. And he pairs these threes with these next words. He says, and not only do you bear, endure, and suffer, but and is kind. And is the key word. It means not only bear, endure, and suffer, but also while you're doing that, be what? Kind. You know, what does kindness mean? Kindness means this, doing something that betters another person. Being kind is not just helping, but helping someone become better in their situation. And there's lots of examples we have at the Christmas season, but other forms of kindness can be this. It can be correction. You know, saying, hey, I see something going in life, and I want you to get better. I want to help you get better, and I want to show you a better way. That's kindness. When we go see someone who's going down the wrong path and say, I want to help you with that. You know, and not getting mad at them, but saying, I want to look at you in love. And that's how Jesus looked at us when we have sinned. He never gets mad at us. Does he get disappointed? Sure, the word says that. Does he get sad? The word says that. But he never gets mad. He says, I love you. And he provides correction so we don't do the same thing again. You know, some people blame God because God doesn't do a bunch of things for them. They ask God, he doesn't do it. Well, there's a reason sometimes God doesn't do it because kindness isn't always just doing something for somebody. Here's the deal. People go, well, God, if you do this for me, then I'll do this for you. Well, that doesn't work. You know why it doesn't work? Because if God does it for you, what's going to happen? You're going to keep doing what you were doing that got you in trouble in the first place because you have no reason to change because your problem's solved. That's how a lot of people want to come to God. God, fix my problem, then I'll come to you. But God says, come to me because you love me. Show me you love me. And guess what? Then I'll fix your problems. Because you know what? I'm going to be kind to you by giving you the choice to love me or not. Because you know what? If God just fixes it and then they go on their merry way and they end up in hell, has God been very kind to them? Absolutely not. God wants us to be in heaven one day. And next one says this. It says he believes, love believes and hopes all things. They believe that there's something better. God over and over again says he has a future for you. He has plans for you. He wants you to be successful in life. He wants to be there for you and all the things you have, but you have to put your hope in him and you have to believe and hope in others. You know what? God believed in you. And he has hopes and plans for you. And why is that? Because you're still alive. You know, he doesn't give up on you ever. But here's the thing, because you know, what do people like to do? Especially when something goes wrong in a loving relationship, they begin to think the worst, don't they? Now, people begin to think, well, God doesn't love me. They think the worst of God because God didn't do this certain thing. But, you know, so many times I find out that I thought to be like, well, why are you in this situation? And I'll find out, well, God said not to do this and you're doing this. what do you expect? You know, God wants to do all these things for us, but he wants us to show love back to him. And the problem is that sometimes we look at people, we don't believe and hope all things. We begin to look at situations and think the worst of it. Oh, and this is happening and that's happening. Or maybe not even in our own relationship, maybe with others. We look at others and say, well, you know, I can't believe and hope they'll be good, that we just need to get rid of them. They need to leave the church, or they need to get out of my life. And we begin to think worse and worse. Because here's the deal. When you begin to think worse and worse, you know what happens? It's harder to think good again. Because, you know, we love to think bad things. It just seems to be part of our nature. And we start letting the things snowball. You know what happens? We then become what? Cynical. And then we're not showing. Then when that person needs love, we're not there to show them love. Because what? We're in this downhill path of being thinking bad thoughts about them. And you know what? That will lead you to disaster. It will destroy your life. Now, you know, these guys, that looks like fun, right? I would love to do that. I'd die, though. But you know what? They're just going downhill fast, not thinking about things. They are going over that road, and then, well, you see, we get going downhill. Just so you know, it's a fake. It's not real. I wouldn't show you something like that. You know, that would be bad to use for a sermon. That's a prank, okay? But y'all, here's what happens. When we start going downhill like that, we don't see the truck coming. Because we're no longer with Jesus. We're now away from him because we're not doing what he asked us to do in love. And that worst thing, that we want something else to happen to somebody else, tends to happen to us. And usually we get hit from the blind side. You don't want to wait till it's too late. So God says we need to do all of these things. He came to show us how to do all of these things that are in this verse here. And when you love like this, this is the love he wants you to have, but you can't pick and choose the ones you want. You can't pick and choose, well, I'm going to believe and hope, but this person really miserable in life, so I'm going to hope God does something bad to them. No, that's not what it says, does it? Well, God, I'm going to love this person, but when they do something to me, I can't put up with them. I'm not going to love them. I'm not going to pray for them. Wait a second, but God says in order to truly love, you got to do it all. You have to be willing to do it. Jesus wants you to know love. What real love is, and he wants you to be successful at love. But the problem is, we as humans, we tend to either take away things from love, because this is exactly what love's supposed to be, or we add things that aren't supposed to be in the realm. We put conditions on love. You know, God's love is unconditional. And why do we do this? Because love is the most important thing in life. But we do that because we need to feel what? Safe. And when it comes to love, we often don't. And Jesus understands that need. And that's why he's so specific here about what love is and what it is not. Because like Jesus, he knows what it is not to be safe in love. He gets abused all the time. There's 7 billion people on the planet. And most studies say about 500 million believe in Jesus Christ. That means 6.5 billion people on the planet do not love Jesus the way they should. They take his name in vain. They could care less about him. About his sacrifice he made on the cross. You talk about being abused. He died for everybody. But the majority of the people could care less what he did on the cross for them. Jesus knows what it is to be hurt. He knows what it is to be abused. His love gets abused all the time. But you know what? He doesn't want you to be abused. And so he gives us the promise. It's in 1 Corinthians 13:8. It says this, love never fails. Now, I've said this quite a few times in church, but I have a little bit of a different take on it as I was praying this week. Jesus is not just saying here, his love will never fail, but he's saying if you love like this, the love that you have will not fail and you'll be safe. He wants you to experience real love. And that means doing everything we just talked about. And you can read it in your Bibles. 1 Corinthians 13:4-7 says, put all this into your life, and if you do that, he promises you that type of love will never fail you. Not only will he never fail you, but you will not be failed. May I say, but Pastor, that's risky to put myself out there, because all this love talks about what? Not you, but giving it away to somebody else. Saying, I am going to show love. But that's tough to do. It's tough to give my heart away, whether it's a relationship, whether it's friends, Sometimes even in families, it's hard to show love because of what's going on. And people might say that it can be dangerous to put yourself out there like that. Most people want to hold their heart in and wait to know for sure they can give it out there. What's God say? Give it out there, and you know what? Your love will never fail. Jesus put himself out there with no guarantee whatsoever. He says, do all this, and love never fails. Because he promises that he will be the one that protects it. He will be the one who protects your love. But you have to practice exactly what he says. You can't deviate from it. You can't say, I'm going to do this and not do this. And you also, what you can't do is add to it. You can't do those things. It says in John, 1 John 4:8, whoever does not love does not know God, for God is. And so here's the deal. Well, love, I know what love means. Well, here's the deal. This statement in 1 Corinthians 13, that is what love is. If you want to know God, you have to love like he says in the Bible. You can't make it up. Trust me, when you make it up, things go wrong because you're never going to know all there is to know about love. Let me tell you that. You're not. But as we love this way, God will come into your lives and you experience God in a new way. Because when you're loving like this, God's going to protect you. He's going to show you things. He's going to let you understand things better. You'll also be able to recognize true love, and you won't have to guess anymore. You'll have a checklist. Well, does this person in my family, or this person I'm dating, or this person I'm with, do they really love me? Well, check the list off. Are they doing all the things that God says love is? If they're missing one, that should be what? A red flag, shouldn't it? Because God says this is the definitive statement on what love is. Try it and see if your life will change. Because we have, the world has all these relationships that fall apart. And why? Because they don't love properly. And God gave us the blueprint. If you do this, you won't have to worry about if you're in love with the person because it'll be well apparent. God will be with you. And what he says, he will protect your love. Your love will never fail. Because he will make sure of that. But you got to do it which way? Your way or his way? That's the hard part. I don't want to do what the... I read it. You know, if you don't try it, practice. Take these three verses and put them somewhere and read them every day. You know, we got to show love every day, don't we? You know, some days we don't feel like showing love, don't we? But we got to look at those and live that way. And God says if you do that, love will not fail. And he uses the word never, and he'll make sure that doesn't happen. So how are we supposed to do this? How can we do this properly? Because, you know, we have a lot of misconceived ideas about love. Whether we're loved personally, whether in a relationship, whether in family, friends. Hey, we're supposed to show love at work, aren't we? We're supposed to do all those different things. So it comes down to these verses here. 1 Corinthians 13:11 through 12. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see in the mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know just as I also am known. Before I extrapolate this verses in conclusion today, you read them at first glance, you might think one thing, but they actually mean the opposite of what they read. I'll explain that in a second. The Apostle John lived longer than any of the apostles. He's the only one that lived to old age in life. Lived to almost 100 years old. Lived at the end of the first century. And at the end of his life, the disciples, the new disciples in the church, they would come and they would pick him up and carry him to church. Today we pick people up to church and, you know, we have a nice van and all that. Imagine during the winter times they would pick him up, had to carry him through the streets. And they would carry him to the church. And at the service, they would go to him and say, Apostle John, would you please give us a word? And every single time they met, he said the same thing. He said this, little children, love one another. And eventually, that's what he would say every single week. Some people might have thought he was senile and lost it. So one day, the disciples of the church came up to him and said, Brother John, you need to say something else. We don't need to hear the same thing every week. And here was the Apostle John's reply. Because it is the commandment of the Lord, and the observation of it alone is sufficient. Little children, love one another. Now, in these two verses in 1 Corinthians 13, 11 to 12, it talks about how Paul says, when I was a child, I spoke, understood, and thought a certain way, and then I became a man. Now, a lot of people read that as about becoming mature in the Lord. But then we get verse 12. Verse 12 says, and now as I'm a man, I see in a mirror that is dimly lit. And then I saw God face to face, and I was known by what I knew. And I only knew in part. What Paul is talking about, he's talking about this, you know. Paul grew up, for lack of a better term, in the church. He grew up being taught as a Pharisee. He was taught the law. And when Jesus died and was resurrected, the apostles were preaching. A guy named Stephen came in and told them about Jesus, and they stoned him to death, and Paul stood by and held the clothes while they killed him. And then Paul got so excited about killing Stephen and these Christians that he asked for letters to go around and put Christians in jail to kill them because he thought he was doing a service for God. And what he's saying is, you know, he's saying is a dim lit. What happened is, as he got older, he kind of got puffed up. He got us knowledge instead of going back to God. He got it from other sources and other things. And he was looking in this mirror and was dimly lit because he had clouded it with his own adult thinking. And then one day he's on the road to Damascus. And while he's on the road to Damascus, he's all excited about going up there and imprisoning a couple thousand Christians and killing them. He's licking his chops. He can't wait. And he actually saw Jesus face to face. Jesus showed up to him in a great light in Acts chapter 9. It said, Saul, why are you persecuting me? You see, Paul thought he knew what love was. He thought he was doing the right thing. And then Jesus showed up, and Paul learned it. I knew in part, and then I was being known by what I was doing, and Jesus wasn't real happy with it. Because, see, as adults, we've either stopped learning about love, or worse, we have complicated it way too much. And why? Because we think as we become an adult, we become better. And what Paul's saying here is, now it's better to have a love like a child. Because, you know, children, you know, they just have that love, they can just give it away. Wednesday night I had Jocelyn came in with you, right? Was that Jocelyn? She comes into the church because they're getting the keys for Connie to go drive the bus to pick up kids. And she walks in, Pastor, hey, I need the van for the keys. And I love you. Isn't that great? Kids just have that thing. They just want to come in. They want to hug. And they want to do all that. What else do kids want to do in their speech and thought? They're always learning. They're soaking things up. They always ask why because they want to know more about it. And they just have this ability just to give their love away. But what do we do as adults? As the older we get, the more we keep love in here, don't we? And Paul is saying, that would happen. I got my mind so focused around things, I had stopped learning about love. I stopped being like a child and soaking in. I thought I had arrived. Then I stood face to face with Jesus. And boy, I learned something. You know, one day we're going to stand face to face to Jesus. Hopefully not like Paul. But he's going to ask you, how did you live your life? Well, you know, I kept it close to the vest. But Jesus says, I told you love won't fail if you do exactly what I tell you to do. And that's the key, doing exactly what he tells you to do. What do kids do? They do exactly, you know, hey, this is what it is. I'm going to do it. I believe. And we need to have a childlike love. There's a huge difference between the two today. I have a song I want to play for you. I was debating all week whether I was going to play it this morning, and then God said, yeah, I want you to play it. So I want you to listen to the words of this song, and then we're going to include the service today. I hope. Here he goes.
Like the leaves falling from the
such an innocent joy of living. He's his father's only son. Don't let me live without a child's love, like the love in this child of mine. Teach me, dear Lord, to have a love for you, a child's love. I let the changes in my season steal the passion from my heart, like the roses fade in the winter, all the petals fall apart, till a young voice gives my withered soul a rejuvenating smile, and those small hands clasped around me erase the hardship for a while. Don't let me live without a child's love, like the love in this child of mine. Teach me again about a child's love and share in the best of my time. Oh, and don't let me live without a child's love, like the love in this child of mine. Teach me, dear Lord, to have a love for you, a child.
You know, in the Bible, we're only ever called children, right? That's how God wants us to love. You know, he's talking at this song, and he looks at that child, and just one voice, hearing his voice changes his world. You know what he talks about? The fears. You know, that's the one reason we don't love like a child, because we have these fears built in. And seasons of change, you know, things change and all that. But you know what? God's love never changes. He doesn't want us to change in how we love one another. But it seems as we get older, we seem to become less loving. We even teach our children, well, you know, you got to be careful about that. What does God want us to do? He wants us to put our love out there and just give it away. The world would be a better place. You would have a better relationship. You'd know what real love is. You know why? Because when we do that the way God asks us to do, then love will not fail. If we don't do it the way God asks us to do, yeah, love will fail you. Because remember, God's an all-in person. You either do it, if you don't do it his way, you can't expect his promises. And he was the came at Christmas to be the ultimate example of that. People picked on him. People hated him. Even his own family. Apostles betrayed and denied him. Whole city that worshipped him 3 days earlier as the coming Messiah then decided to crucify him. But yet he loved them all the time. He never wavered from that promise. You can read through the entire life of him, and he never once wavers from the fact that he didn't love anybody. He never stopped loving anybody. And he always kept giving away. He still does it to this day. He is a gracious God. The fact that you're still here, he's a gracious God. He says he wants you to love like a child. You might say, but, you know, my job as a parent is to protect my children. There's a reason we call God Abba Father. He said, if you love the way I tell you to, your love won't fail because I'll be there to protect you. I am the best parent there is. And what is the basis of love? The basis of love is trust, right? Do you trust God just to love simply, like a child, that he'll protect you and it won't fail? Or do you say, well, I don't know if I can do all that. I got to make up my mind and do it my way. What are you telling God? That you don't what? Trust him. He came to show us the example of love, that we need to give it away. And it all come back to us. You know what? And people say, well, that's dangerous to do. I mentioned that word earlier. Here's the thing you got to realize about that. When you love like that, you become dangerous. Because anybody comes against you when you love like that, they're not messing with you anymore. They're messing with your dad. And he will show up when you do that. And that's why he says love never fails. He says, if you love like this, I know it's hard. I know it's risky. If you do that and open yourself up like that, you will open yourself up to the promises of the Lord. But you got to be willing to do that because that's what the world needs. True love that is selfless and given away. You realize that God will be there for you. And you will be safe. Today we're going to have an altar call and I'm going to play a song. It's called You Gotta Give It Away. That's what we got to do. But you might be here today and say, you know, I don't feel safe in my relationships. Maybe it's with your family. Maybe it's with someone you love. Maybe it's your coworkers. And I don't feel safe showing love like that because I've been hurt before. Well, guess what? I have good news for you today. The altars are going to be open. I want to pray with you. And you got to want to have it. You got to want to come down. It's not going to be a hand raised today. But if you come down here, you know what God says? It begins to say, at this point, you're safe again. Now, God, does he expect you to be perfect? He expects you to do your best. When you mess up, hey, get back to doing the right thing. He knows we're not going to be perfect. But he wants us to do what he asks us to do. And he promises love will not fail you. You know, what if you're here today and you have defined love in your life and it isn't working out for you? Well, guess what? If you've defined love your way, that's why it ain't working out. But today, if you come forward today, you can tell God, hey, I want to define love your way. You know what? The relationship in your life will change. Another thing you got to ask yourself, have you lost that loving feeling? There's no reason why love shouldn't permeate us. We should be able to be like a kid and run to one another and just love one another. And that includes our relationships at home. You know what I'm talking about. It can make that better. Because God wants to protect all of that that goes together. He wants to make your relationships. And sometimes people fall away. They're in love, but then they fall away from one another. Why is that? You got to keep doing all these things and your love will continue to grow and it won't go backwards. Are you afraid to love like Jesus wants you? Yeah, that's it. It can be. But God's here to empower you today. Or maybe you're here today and say, you know what? I want love in my life. I don't got it. I'll tell you something. Jesus wants to give it to you. He wants to change your life for the better. I say, well, can God do that? Sure he can. If you're in this room, you're wondering, well, what's God done for me? Well, you know what? Hey, you're still here, right? God's giving you a chance to come to him. He wants you to live forever in heaven. He doesn't want you to live in hell. I got a question. What do you have to lose? What do you have to lose? Love is the most important thing in our life. When we don't feel loved, then people feel, that's how depression happens. That's how relationships fall apart. That's how people come, we just grow apart. God wants that love to always be there. We got to be like what? A child's love. So today I'm going to play this song. It says, you got to give it away. And while I'm doing that, if you have that today, you want to experience love, you want to be prayed for today, I want you to come forward. We all need more love in our life. I would love it if you all came forward. Because you know what? God wants to give you, what's our word for the year? More. Who wouldn't want more love in their life? Is it easy to do all these things? No, I'll tell you right now, I'm a pastor. I don't do them all right. And I have to get down on my knees and say, God, forgive me. But you know what? Because I attempt to do them to the best of my ability, I can tell you, love has never failed me in anything that's happened in my life. There have been times I've doubted. You know when I doubted? That's when I got my life off of love. When I got back to loving and doing things, that's when things changed. God wants to be with you. He wants you to have a life full of love, like he was. So the altars are open. I'd like you to come forward. And let's pray over you today. Hopefully, it works. The altars are open.
She asked him for forever and a promise that would last. He said, baby, no, I love you, but I can't commit to that. She said, love isn't love till you give it away.
Do you have a childlike love today? If you don't, come forward. Let us return to your life today. Nothing more important than this in our lives, what Jesus came to show us. Give it away. You have something in your life that's unsettled. You need to come forward. Because this is what will settle it. Guarantee you. I can say that because I know it in my life. Don't leave here without having that. Lord wants to renew your love today. He wants you to walk out of here feeling amazing. But you gotta want it. You gotta want it. And God, He will teach you so much about it. It's the last chorus. Anybody else want to join us up front before we pray? Love you. The most important thing in this world is having a loving relationship. Remember, we don't believe in religion here. We believe in what? Relationship. And what's the basis of any good relationship? Love. And God gives us, and you know what? It's so important to him that he gave us step-by-step instructions of how to make that good in your life. Isn't that great? That's how much he loves you. And he says, if you follow those instructions, love will never fail. It's not that God's love doesn't fail. It means your love won't fail you. Because God will be there. He has to show up and support you in those moments. Isn't that amazing? But when we try to do it our way, why is God going to show up? It says, trust me. Do what I say. I gave you instructions. I didn't give them because I didn't have anything else to do but talk about it. He gave those instructions. Why? Because he wants you to be successful. He wants you to have love. He doesn't want you to be depressed. He doesn't want you to be able to walk around and look at someone and hug on them. Now, before I pray today, I want everybody to turn to somebody. Everybody needs to buddy up with somebody. And look him square in the eye. This only works if you look him square in the eye. All right, everybody got a partner? Find a partner. If you see somebody, hey, or get three people together, I don't care. But here we go. I want you to look at him in the eyes. And say, I love you. Now here's a harder one. And I want you to look at their eyes. And you need to be honest when you say this one. And if you can't say it, or you have tears of emotion that come inside of you, it's okay. But look at the person you're with and say, I know I'm loved. Anybody here have a problem with that? Because here's the deal. You know, I got some people hugging. You know what? We need to love each other like a child loves. And if you looked in the other person's eyes and you saw something in their eye, we need, right now I'm going to pray for everybody here. I want you to put your hand on them or give them a hug. You know, we're allowed to do that. And you know what? And let's pray today. I'm going to pray for you right now. Dear Lord, I pray for all those who are up here right now. Lord, we all desperately need love. And Lord, you came to show us we can have it. But so many of us as adults are afraid to totally go out there with love because we've been hurt. Because we don't feel safe. But God, you came to show us that you've been through it all, Jesus. To show us that we can go through it too. And because of that, you want us to love like you do. That you promised that if we do that, our love won't fail. And we love like God asks us to love. Here's what happens. God says, I will do things for you. I will move the mountains for you because that's what I want you to be. And Lord, we need to love like little children. As Apostle John said, little children love one another. Well, stop looking at all the things that are going on and say, I love you the way Jesus does. I love you. And we'll start doing that to those around us. They might see something different. They might see a difference in our life. They might not like what's going on or maybe ridicule us, but that's when God will show up because that's the love they're looking for because when you do that, you'll know real love. You also know when someone's being fake to you because you can check it off by what God says because this is what real love is. I ask you to bless all those that came forward today, Lord, to show a special anointing of love in their life that they've never felt before. Let them walk out of here with the feeling that, man, I'm in love just like I was the first time. And then never let that feeling go away. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Now look at, now before we leave, everybody look at each other. You will all have times where you feel unloved. I have times like that. We all do. But here's what we got to understand. That's the reason we have church. So we can come together and love on one another. When you need that, call on somebody else. That's why we're starting the care ministry. They're going to call you and they're going to love on you. And here's how we need to love on one another. Just like a kid. We need to go up to people and go, hey, Rob, it's great to see you. I love you, man. Now you're laughing at that. But it says in the Bible, when the apostles got there, they greeted one another with a holy kiss. I'm not that far. I'm not that far. Too many connotations in this world. But you know what? They were genuinely excited to see one another because they genuinely loved one another. But what happened as the church got older? That love started to go away. It's why the Revelation was written, why the epistles were written. Jesus wants us to truly love one another. He wants to go up and say, hey, you know what? I love you. And when you're having a bad week or you do something wrong, it's okay. We all will. But we're going to love you back to health. We're going to love you back to be clean again because we want the best for you. And when we do that, God will bless us. The gifts will return to the church and return to your life, and your life will change. So when you go out this week, here's your challenge. It's one thing to come forward. It's another thing to take this and then go out in the world and do it. If you're married, make sure you love your wife a little more this week. If you're not married, love your significant other the way God says. All right. Let me explain. But when you're at your coworkers, your family, when you greet somebody, just don't go, hi. Hey, I love you. And actually mean it. When someone causes you a problem, that doesn't mean we wash the problem away. We got to help them and all that. But still say, I love you. When somebody provokes you and you just want to knock them upside the head, say, I love. No. But you know what? When you tell them I love you and you really mean it and they are provoking you, something's happening, God will take his fist. And you know what? He's a little bit stronger than you are. And if he doesn't, then the verse, love never fails, doesn't work. And I can give you example after example in my life where God's fist has done something to somebody else. But not because he's being vindictive, because he's trying to change them too, but he's also protecting me. And he can protect you. Have a great week. If you want to stay for a Jesus class, it's over in the gym with lunch. And missions, we'll have a really short 10-minute meeting. Praise the Lord. Have a great week. And we'll see you next week.